Today we will discuss about the Buddhism, and as earlier we will complete in the two class. In the first class we will learn what is Buddhism, what are its basic principle, how it emerged, and what is the current status of Buddhism. And after understanding the Buddhism, in the next class, we will see the educational philosophy of Buddhism, or you can understand that educational implication of Buddhist philosophy. So that we will see in the first next class. Now come to the Buddhism. When we see the genesis of Buddhism, it is a time of way back in the 5th to 6th century BC. Okay, so at that time there was a two type of a school of a philosophy. One philosophy, we know that they were accepting the Vedas, and they were also accepting the religious literature, religious doctrine. So they were known as a orthodox. And basically when we talk about the India, because it has emerged in the India, then in the India, the one of the religion was the Hinduism. That is also known as the Sanatan Dharma at that time. Sanatan Dharma was orthodox. And in the orthodox, there was a concept of a god. There was a concept of a worship of a god. And they were defining on the basis of religious doctrine available at that time. However, in the complex time, those were unable to answer the all type of sufferings, all type of curiosity out of the human mind. And at that time, due to, you can say, the inability to address all the problem of orthodox philosophical schools, a heterodox, or you can say that not a theist, atheist philosophical school emerged. So the emergence of Buddhism, Jainism, even the Chavaka was in the response of inability of orthodox school to address the issue. But before understand the Buddhism, one thing I will like to say, that there was a two prominent school of a philosophy at that time. One was the Jainism, which we have seen, we have already studied, that Jainism was extremely inclined towards the morality, moral development, and the emancipation. It was extremely inclined. On the other side, when we talk about the Chavarka school of philosophy, it was inclined towards the materialism. Chavarka rejected the belief that offered by the Jainism, and it was inclined towards the materialism. There was a more space of samsara, atman in the and the soul in the Jainism philosophy. It was rejected by the Chavarka. And here the karma was a center in the Chavarka philosophy, isn't it? So these were the two prominent schools at that time. Now in the 5th to 6th century BC, because there is a disagreement among the scholars of the Buddhism that when the Buddha took birth and what was the time period of a Buddha. But in the majority of a document, the Gautam Buddha's life is traced, and it is accepted also that it was between 563 BC to 483 BC. That was the life of Buddha. And he took birth in a Lumbini, a place Lumbini, which is now in the Nepal. Earlier it was a one country. It was there, but was not a separate one, it was one. So now it is in a Nepal. And he was a son of a king, ruler in a Shakya clan. Isn't it? And since at that time there was a two orthodox and heterodox school of a philosophy, or you can say the Hinduism. So one of the holy person, you can say that the Sant, they have predicted that Siddhartha, because the Gautam Buddha original name was the Gautam, so Siddhartha Gautam. Buddha was added later on, that we will see what is meaning and what are these things. So he predicted that the Siddhartha, either he will be a good and a great king and a military leader, or he will become a great spiritual leader. So the father of a Siddhartha Gautam was afraid, and he has made a palace, an arrangement in a such a way to bring all the facility of a life within a palace, and he was spending his life in a palace only. He was not going outside in the society. And till the age of 13 years, he was in the palace only. And at the age of 7 years, his mother died. At the age of 16 years, he married, and after the marriage also he spent his life of another 13 years in the palace. So you can think that total 29 years of his life he spent in the palace. He didn't went out, because all the kind of a facility was available there. Whatever you can think of, all the things was available there. Then one day he went out in his chariot, that is the rath. He went out, and when he went out, he saw that there is an aged man. He asked that who is and why he is like that. Then he has been replied that at a one point of a time, everyone will be aged. There was a sick man. He asked, then what is this? Yeah, that at a point we get a sick. He saw a dead man, and the family members were crying. Then he had been replied that at a point, all who are taking birth, they will get died. And he also found a saint, ascetic, tapasvi, who is detached himself from the all the physical pleasure. He asked, who is he? He had been replied that he is in a search of the truth. Then he asked that, am I too a subject of this? So at some point of a time I will be also aged, I will also get a sick, I will also die? Then he had been replied, yes, this is the truth. Then he found that the kind of a life he is spending is not very much fruitful. He must search the truth. What is the meaning of human life? How a human should live life? Then he started searching. Then he was mediating. There is a long story of a mediation also, his mediation, mediating practices. And at last he was mediating in a banyan tree in Bodh Gaya, which is in the Bihar. He found the truth. He got the point. And then he have been named as the Gautam Buddha. Buddha is who is enlightened. So he got the enlightenment, and that's why his name become Gautam Buddha. Then the tree is also known as a Bodhi tree, which is in the Gaya. Then he started teaching that what he has learned out of the meditation and how to mediate meditation. He started teaching how to meditate. Then he has come up with a four truth, which is known as a four noble truth of the Buddhism. And he also come up with the eightfold path. So he has come up with a four noble truth and eightfold path. These four noble truths are that the life have a suffering, every life have a suffering, that is known as a dukkha. In a life there is a dukkha, but there is a cause of a suffering. Everyone have a suffering, but there is a cause of a suffering, that is the samudaya. And there is an end of a suffering, nirodha. Then there is a path to free us from the suffering, that is the magga, that is the mark. Because when you see the original literature of a Buddhism is in the Prakrit language. There was a two language at that time, Pali and Prakrit. So when you will find the Jainism literature, it is in the Pali language, and the Buddhism literature, it is in the Prakrit language. No, don't confuse it with the Sanskrit. Sanskrit is different. Prakrit, still the language is there in the, and in so many university they are being taught also. Like that in the Magad University, when you will go to the Bodh Gaya, Pali and Prakrit is still there. You can do masters in the Pali and Prakrit. So he taught that there are four truths in the life. The first is that there is a suffering. If we have come to the earth, then there will be the incident where you may suffer. The suffering may be the detachment of your family members. The suffering may be from the physical sufferings, like the hurt you get in your body. The suffering may be the losing someone's. So when you take birth, there is a suffering. And there is a cause of a suffering also. Cause of a suffering is being attached to someone's too much. If you are attached to someone's too much, then there will be a suffering. Then the suffering, there is an end of a suffering also. The pain, the dukkh that you have, that will end sometime. It is not a permanent in nature. Like that, we have our family members, let it be mother, father, brother, sister, husband, wife, children, whoever. We are attached to them. And when some unpleasant thing happens to them, we feel sadness, we feel pain. Why we feel pain? Because we are attached to them. There are a lot of people in the world who are suffering, but we don't feel pain always, unless or until we are attached to them. And the sufferings are not permanent in nature. There will be an end of a suffering also. And in order to end, there is a path, there is a way. And when we see collectively, this truth explains why human hurt and how to overcome out of the hurt. And he explained the attachment, too much concern and the attachment of a person with someone is the main cause of a suffering. If we are attached, then we will suffer. Isn't it? Then he also come up with the eightfold path. And these two things, that is the four noble truth and eightfold path, these are the basic principle of Buddhism. In the first, that is the four noble truth, he explained that is why we are suffering and how we, and there is an end of a suffering. In the eightfold path, Buddha taught his followers that the end of a suffering, as described in the four noble path, that is noble truth, could be achieved by the eightfold path. Because in the four truth, noble truth, he is saying that there is a suffering, there is a cause of a suffering, there is an end of suffering also, and there is a way of a coming out of a suffering. So these way of coming out of a suffering is listed under the eightfold path. If you will practice eightfold path, then you will come out of the suffering. Here, whatever the eightfold path I will explaining, or which is suggested by Buddha, is not in the hierarchical order, like that one by one you have to do. These are in total, which is based upon the ethical conduct, mental discipline, and achieving the wisdom. This eightfold path is based upon these three principles: ethical conduct, mental discipline, and achieving wisdom. In this eightfold path, the Buddha says that the first one, right understanding, samadhi. If you understand the dynamics, the relations, the dependency, in a right way, in an appropriate way, then it will lead to reduce the suffering. Right understanding. Then right thought, which is the sama sankappa. you may be finding that the right thought is the sama sankappa. So I was saying that you might be thinking that apart from the English word that I am saying, it is looking like Hindi, but it is not Hindi because it is in a Prakrit language. That's why you are not finding familiarity with those words. Right thought says that your thinking, your thought process, your attitude must be right. And if it is a right, then you can get out of the sufferings. Then right speech, your speech, your talk must be right. Then right action, your action, your act, your doing for your own life, towards the nature, towards the other person, must be right. Then the right livelihood. So your livelihood practices, your life practices, your practices of earning something for your life must be right. Then the right effort, your effort must be right for doing anything. Then the right mindfulness. So if your mind, if your thought, if your thinking pattern is right, then it will lead to the coming out of the suffering. And the last one is the right concentration. Sama samadhi. You should concentrate, you should meditate in order to come out of the sufferings. So the sama samadhi, that is the right concentration, sama sati, that is the right mindfulness, then sama vyama, that is the right effort, sama ajiva, right livelihood, sama kamanta, that is the right action, sama vaka, that is the right speech, sama sankampa, that is the right thought, sama diti, that is the right understanding. These are the way to come out of the sufferings, because suffering is a truth. There will be a suffering. So these are the way by which you can come out of the suffering. Then one thing I was saying before, that there was a two extreme points in the atheist philosophy. That one was the Jainism and another was the Chavarka. Jainism was extremely inclined towards the world. I was saying that the Chavarka was extremely inclined towards the materialism, and the Jainism was extremely inclined towards the morality, emancipation. And from the meditation, whatever the enlightenment the Buddha got, he proposed that extreme point is not a solution. Either we are extreme in the side of a Jainism, or we are extreme in the side of a Chavarka. And that's why he has given a concept of a middle path. And he told that middle path is the best path. Middle path is the best path. He come up with this conception. And that's why, in order to understand Buddhism, understanding Chavurka and understanding Jainism is important. Because in contrast with this, and where they were becoming a failure, this Buddhism will come. So Buddhism came in response with the failure of the orthodox philosophy, in response with the Jainism, and in response with the Chavarka. So in this context, Buddhism emerged. And at that time, Buddhism nurtured and flourished in so many countries. And as it was spreading, it divided into the several parts also. There are several parts of a Buddhist and Buddhism religion. When we talk about as it was spreading, it had several different school of a thought within the Buddhism. The one is that you must be knowing, it is a popularly known as the Hinayana. Okay, so Hinayana is the oldest school of the Buddhism, which is also known as the Theravada Buddhism. It is the oldest school in the Buddhism, Theravada, which is mostly found in the Thailand, Sri Lanka, Cambodia, Laos and Burma. And there is a Mahayana Buddhism, which is the great vehicle, known as a great vehicle, which came later on. The oldest one is the Hinayana. Later on, the Mahayana came, which is available in the China, Japan, Taiwan, Korea, Singapore and Vietnam. And there is also one more school in the Buddhism, which is known as the Tibetan Buddhism, which is known as the Vajrayana Buddhism. Vajrayana or the Tibetan Buddhism, which is basically in the Tibet, Nepal, Mongolia, Bhutan and the some part of Russia and northern India. So these are the three schools within the Buddhism.